سبحانك اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا اللهم علما وعملا متقبلا آمين يا رب العالمين. We begin today and inshallah we will try to complete it today, the review, discussion, analysis and critique of this book, the negative impact of fabricated hadith upon the image of Islam, by Associate Professor Dato Arif Perkasa, Dr. Muhammad Asri bin Zainul Abidin, published by Jabatan Mufti Negeri Perlis, State of Perlis in Malaysia. Immediately from the title, we realize that this is the exact same title that Nasir al-Albani, the famous, notorious Wahhabi scholar of Hadith, السلسلة الضعيفة في الأحاديث الموضوعة والضعيفة وأثرها السيء في الإسلام. The negative impacts of the weak and forged hadiths on Islam or on the Ummah. This is the exact same title that has been borrowed, as if to say the author is intending to imitate and follow and reduplicate basically the very same type of work as Al-Albani did in his, but the Albani's book was something like 10 volumes or 11 volumes. It was thousands of pages. Whereas this one is barely 50 pages. The introductory material is basically just copy and paste of various issues, such as the definition, of course, that he has to define. So he used the book of our teacher, Dr. Nuruddin Itr of Damascus, to define it. The completion of the definition of the fabricated hadith by our Sheikh Nuruddin Itr mentions that these are not hadiths in reality. So these are statements that are being mistakenly, whether on purpose or unwittingly, attributed to the Prophet upon him and his family and companions, blessings and peace. Anyway, what I propose to do is to just skip directly to the passages that struck me as incorrect and as misleading, actually, and thus creating another issue within the treatment of forged hadith, that the treatment itself contains forgery, unfortunately, which is the case with the mother book of Sheikh Nasir al-Albani. There are so many wrong statements. So before I start with that, perhaps I should point the reader to an antidote to that particular issue about the problem with al-Albani. This is it. It was published in 2007 at Beacon Books. And as you can see, it is quite a large book with a very full index for easier reference. And it is arranged, in fact, alphabetically. So there's two kinds of accessing all of the hadiths. But what I want to point out is that I added another book to this book, which is my own introduction on the discipline of forgeries. This is the introduction. You see this part. And that's the rest of the book. So the introductory part is 233 pages in itself. So it's a book in itself. And as part of that book, there is this section starting here, 5.4, the status of al-Albani and his hadith works. So let us say you are impressed with al-Albani and you start taking rulings from al-Albani. You start taking positions on what qualifies as a weak hadith or a sahih hadith. what qualifies as a true authentic hadith, what qualifies as a forgery from Al-Albani and no one else, you are going to fall for sure. This is not a prophecy or a prediction. This is a fact. You are going to fall into mistakes and you are going to be misguided on one issue or another regarding whether aqidah or fiqh or hadith terminology, hadith science, hadith nomenclature. I have listed here from their own words, not from my own, but I have done the research to list all of those that disagreed with Al-Albani. And you can see here that these are, in fact, big authorities. For example, the Indian hadith scholar, rahimahullah, Habib al-Rahman al-Azami, he wrote a book called Al-Albani's Aberrations and Errors. Al-Albani shudhuduhu wa akhta'uhu, his deviations and errors. So Saudi hadith scholar Ismail ibn Muhammad al-Ansari wrote Critique of Al-Albani's Compilation of Weak and Forged Hadiths. I want to ask the author of this book that we are about to analyze, are you aware of these critiques? Have you taken them into consideration? Have you read them, studied them, and assessed their value? Or are you just dismissing them, whether out of pure ignorance that they exist or whether you consider that they are all wrong? The Saudi scholar Abdullah Saleh, with his book At-Ta'qibat Al-Maliha, Entertaining Correctives, on Al-Albani's other book, Al-Silsila Al-Sahiha. Even in his book on Sahih Hadith, he made a ton of mistakes, as well as, not to mention, يعني, the Silsila Da'ifa. The Saudi scholars, Abdullah ibn Muhammad ibn Ahmad al-Duwaysh, he passed away, rahimahullah. He was young. He was one of those that did not reach the age of 40. And his life is described in one such book, Man lam yablugh sin al ashad, those who did not reach their full, the peak of their strength. And yet he was a highly praised scholar of hadith in Saudi Arabia. And another one also who collaborated with him, Abdul Aziz ibn Muhammad al Mushayqih, with their book Tanbih al Qari, notifying the reader. We are warning you, O reader. So if you are a specialist and you want to approach it, make it, dumb it down to the amma, to the awam, the general layperson, it is a duty on you to inform yourselves of this literature. Otherwise, you are not qualified. Notifying the reader of the strength of what Albani declared weak. This is a list of his mistakes in that. Followed by another book by them, تنبيه القاري لتضعيف ما قواه الألباني, notifying the reader of the weakness of what Albani declared strong. In other words, he gives topsy-turvy rulings, turns things upside down, subhanallah, exactly like as predicted by the Holy Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم في آخر الزمان. يخون الأمين ويصدق الكاذب. Trustworthy will be declared untrustworthy, and the liar will be declared reliable. That is the state of our times. The late Syrian scholar Muhammad Saleh Ahmad al-Khatib with Al-Istijaba li Nusrat al-Khulafa al-Rashidin wa al-Sahaba. This is on a particular issue of Al-Albani, where he claimed that only 8 rak'at is valid and sahih for... This is a new position. Even the Wahhabi scholars of Saudi Arabia, one and all, completely disagreed with Al-Albani on this, because he was the first one who was not accepting the 20 rak'at as being as not being a bid'ah, or as being a sunnah. He is declaring that they are not a sunnah, but a bid'ah. Whereas the Khulafa al-Rashidin adopted that 20 rak'at, and the Prophet ﷺ said, عليكم بسنتي وسنتي خلفاء الرشيدين المهديين من بعد. The Prophet ﷺ made it obligatory on your neck. So finish, no more discussion after that, that you must follow my sunnah and the sunnah of the Khulafa al-Rashid. It's like maybe a Quran only person. is like that kind of heresy, to say unless we see it in the Holy Quran, then we do not accept it. Like how the Holy Quran tells you, obey the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So therefore, this puts all of the Sunnah of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his statements, his commands, and his practices, as part of the or a command of the Quran. So to deny the Sunnah would be to be denying the Quran. And if the Sunnah makes something of the acts of the Khulafa al-Rashidin al-Mahdin as part of it, then that it becomes Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that's the first issue that comes to mind. From the cover itself, there is a red flag. Pay attention to that red flag. And then let's see what he says about this one of the fabricated hadiths that he quotes as examples. These examples are very telling of his method or lack thereof. He says, a fabricated narration says, إِذَا جَامَعَ أَحَدُكُمْ زَوْجَتَهُ etc. Meaning, when one of you is having intercourse with his wife or female slave, he shall not look unto their genitals, for that would cause blindness. He calls this a forgery. According to, he says, a number of hadith scholars, including Ibn al-Jawzi, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, As-Suyuti, Al-Albani, and others. This is incorrect. Only Ibn al-Jawzi and Al-Albani qualify as having said that this is a flat-out forgery. Whereas Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani and As-Suyuti differed with that ruling. And the reference for that is the very same reference that he gives at the bottom. Yani Suyuti al-La'ali al-Masnu'a. His encyclopedia on forgeries, Imam Suyuti's, where he discusses this ruling and he rejects it. And he states that Ibn Hajar also rejected it. And the confirmation of that also is given by Al-Qattan in his book on Ahkam al-Nadhar, yani the legal rulings concerning all the types of gaze and the types of sighting something with the eyes, the halal and the haram of it in all of the situations. It is a very blessed and useful book covering, among other things, this very issue. Next, on page 25 of his book, the author says that a proof of the fact that it is permitted and that therefore the other narration must be a forgery is that Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha said, I used to have a bath with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the same vessel, yani the same container of water. He was faster than me, and then I would say, leave some for me, leave some for me, narrated by Al-Bukhari, Muslim, and others. But you can immediately see that there is no explicit statement to the effect that it is permitted or not permitted. But what the author wants us to take from that is that for sure, then he must have looked at hers, and she must have looked at his, and so forth. This also is not accepted as a proof. And it also, there is another issue of lack of adab therein. But anyway, if you look at Ibn al-Jawzi himself, who had said that the other one is a forgery, then the author here, Zainul Abidin, is saying that this hadith confirms it, but this hadith was not included by Ibn al-Jawzi himself on his review of the adab of the Prophet ﷺ with his wives in the situation of intercourse. In Kitabul Wafa, bi ahwali al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In that book, he mentions that Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha said verbatim and explicitly, and that's what we are looking for, something that at least approaches an explicit statement to that effect. I never looked at his and he never looked at mine, or I never saw his and he never saw mine, when asked the very same question. So, and there's other reports also from Salama and from others in that same chapter on Adabuhu fin nikah. So look it up in that book of Al-Wafa, يعني fulfillment of the promise concerning the description of the states of the elect prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم الوفاء بأحوال المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم. The next passage that drew my attention is on page 26, where he claims that the hadith that states that anyone named Muhammad and Ahmad will not enter hellfire is for sure a forgery. Because he states, in his own opinion, it contradicts with the fact that the admittance into Jannah or hellfire is through the weight of good practice. We ask one thing. The hadith in question, there are actually 30 hadiths on naming one's son, Ahmad, Muhammad, Hamad, Hamid, all of these derivatives of Hamida to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are all considered as synonyms of the name Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the strongest hadith to that effect, according to Imam As-Suyuti, is whoever names their son upon their birth, Ahmad or Muhammad, as a blessing. That is narrated from Abu Umama al-Bahili, Yemeni Sahabi, will enter paradise. Now, naming one's son in order to be blessed by being assimilated or affiliated to the Prophet ﷺ through sharing the same name, is that an act or not an act? Does it qualify as an act? If you say no, it doesn't qualify as an act because it's just a name, it's just a word that you are using, then I ask you about the first rukun of Islam. Is shahada and la ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah an act or just a word that people are saying? It is an act. It is the first act of the five arkan of Islam, the five pillars of Islam, which are all acts that are visible, audible by people, and that are outward. They qualify as acts. So, أحسن العمل ومن آمن وعمل صالحا, the first salih that they do, those who believe in their hearts, is to express the iman in their hearts, to say shahada an la ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah. So that qualifies as an act. Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani gives you a rule of thumb to always use concerning hadiths that are considered very weak or unreliable, inauthentic, and so forth. He says, when you have lots and lots of narrations to the same effect, that is an indication that there is an asl to the meaning, the general meaning of that hadith. When there is a lot of narrations to that effect. And this is one of them. And the proof of it is that Ibn Bukair has compiled no less than 30 hadiths to that effect. So there is definitely an asl, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. So anyway, we go on to the next passage, where he claims that, quote, musalsal hadith on shaking hands are false. And he claims that this is from Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda's annotations on Zafar al-Amani by Imam al-Laknawi. He does not mention that it is by Imam al-Laknawi, by the way. Anyway, this is not the words of Sheikh Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda. I have that book, alhamdulillah. I've studied it also, Zafar al-Amani, with the annotations of Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda. And on that, on the page of that reference, it does not say musalsal hadith on shaking hands are false. It says this musalsal hadith is false. This one, meaning this particular one with this chain through al-Mu'ammar, is false. So this is tahrif, basically. It's just, you know, tempering and changing. So that, what is your purpose in that? You want to make it a hukum am. You want to say all of it is false. It is all to be rejected. And this is just a lie. You cannot just extrapolate a hukum am from one example on which everyone concurs. Whereas, in fact, no one is arguing about that. So pick something that where you bring us new knowledge, But this is not new knowledge at all. But this is in fact a tampering and a misleading statement. Then he extrapolates more on that. He says all of the people who narrate those are arranging special events to accept the shake hand ijaza from them in order to achieve power or status or self-importance. Alhamdulillah, on the day of Qiyamah, we leave that between you and Ibn al-Jawzi, al-Sakhawi, al-Suyuti, Isa al-Fadani, al-Ala'i, and many others that have hadith or that, Hasr al-Sharid by Muhammad Abid al-Sindi, the scholar of Medina, the one of the greatest hadith scholars of Medina in his time. Also an encyclopedia of Musalsalat. So this was, according to you, just self-display and riya. Yani kufr asghar. Is this what you are claiming? You want to be their opponent on Yawm al-Qiyamah? We leave that to you and them. And we say, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-ali al-azim. He does not understand that he is hitting all of those people. Of course, he would never dare to do that if he knew. But he thinks he is hitting a group that is an easy target. And these are the Sufis. He says, this is exactly what happened to deviant sects. He means by that the Sufis. Summarized by the statement, be in front of your teacher just like a corpse in front of the person who is bathing him. This is an expression to show that don't object. Don't ask why, because you may not see as far as your sheikh sees. Do you know Sahl al-Tustari, the contemporary of Abu Dawud, al-Sijistani, the author of the Sunan? Sahl al-Tustari, he has a tafsir of Quran, he has many books on tasawwuf. And he says, قُلُوبُ الْعَارِفِينَ لَهَا أَعْيُنٌ. The hearts of the arifin have eyes that see what people do not see, or تَرَى مَا لَا تَرَاهُ النَّاظِرُونَ. Yani those that are gazing and trying to see and understand, they may not see as far as the hearts of the arifin see. This is what is meant by the sheikh who does not like to have objection. And this is accepted by even your putative imam, Ahmad ibn Taymiyyah. Because Ibn Khafif al-Shirazi said, مَنْ قَالَ لِشَيْخِهِ لِمَا لَنْ يَفْلَحْ. Whoever says why to his sheikh will not succeed. And this imam, in his fatawa, Ibn Taymiyyah, calls him one of the great sheikhs of the sunnah, yani of the early centuries, because he died in 300-something. And don't go far. Yani in the Hanbali mazhab, one of the great sheikhs of the sunnah is considered also to be Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jilani. In his book, Kitabul Ghunya, in the section of tasawwuf also, the third part of Kitabul Ghunya, the section on tasawwuf, there is a chapter called The Adab with One's Sheikh. And in that book, he says, وَلْيَتَحَقَّقْ. So this is in the second volume, page 280 of Kitab al-Ghunya. He says, وَلْيَتَحَقَّقْ. You have to realize, or that one, that seeker has to realize, بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ أَجْرَى الْعَادَةَ بِأَنْ يَكُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it i'ada, a custom. Yani this is one of the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the face of the earth. This, the customs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in treating creation. أَنْ يَكُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. That there must be on earth shaykh wa murid. That state of shaykh and murid. Either you are shaykh or you are murid. There is no third. And this is based on the statement of Ibn Mas'ud. كنت عالما أو متعلما ولا ثالث لهما. Either you are a عالم or you are a seeker of علم, and there is no third to them. The third one is cursed if you are neither. So شيخ or مريد, which one are you? صاحب ومصحوب. يعني the صاحب, the one who seeks the صحبه of someone, and the one who is giving that صحبه, he is the مصحوب. That is the state of things that Allah decreed on the face of the earth, according to Shaykh Abdul Qadir al-Jilani al-Hanbali, who is the pride and the pride and joy of Ahmad ibn Taymiyyah in his Silsila Sufiyyah, because Ahmad ibn Taymiyyah himself said, I took tasawwuf, and I took tariqa through my shuyukh, and he names them from Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jinani, and this is the greatest of the turuq, the tariq of Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jinani. And then he says, tabi' wa matbu', yani follower and the one who is followed, min ladun Adam ila an taqum as-sa'a, from Adam, because he was following Sayyidina Jibril alayhi salam, until the day of resurrection. So that is our authority between our proof and our argument between you and us on the day of Qiyamah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And then he said a famous hadith from the Musnad of Imam Ahmad. He states that this hadith is a forgery. That is the hadith from Aisha, that she heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam say, I saw Abdurrahman ibn Auf entering paradise crawling. And he states, this is a fabricated hadith. Ibn al-Jawzi said, Ahmad ibn Hanbal said, this hadith is false and fabricated. Which is very strange, because he himself narrated it. Imam Ahmad narrated it in his Musnad, and yet he says that it is false and fabricated. Ibn Hajar has the opinion that perhaps he changed his mind and he wanted it to be taken out of the Musnad, but his son, Abdullah, who was the general editor of the Musnad of Imam Ahmad after his time, decided to keep it, to leave it in, or omitted it by mistake, and it stayed. But the truth is that after saying that, Ibn Hajar, in his discussion of the questionable hadiths in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, in a specific book that he authored just for that topic, called Al-Qawl Al-Musaddad fi Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, he mentions many other narrations confirming the truth of this hadith. But he does not like to say that Imam Ahmad might have been mistaken. So he leaves it at that. He was extremely full of adab and very gentle in his rulings. And so he leaves it to the reader to understand that there are actually proofs to that effect. So as to say that Ash-Shawkani said, and Abdurrahman Al-Hut, one of our contemporaries, has said this, this is not acceptable in light of the the book of Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani dedicated to that topic, and you do not quote that. So we have to understand that that's another general rule that Imam Ibn Hajar gave us. There is no forged hadith in Musnad al-Imam Ahmad. Try as you may, you will not find it. There will always be a counterproof that is just strong enough to give you pause and to know for sure that a hadith is a forgery, is just as difficult, if not more difficult, than to know for sure that it is mass transmitted, mutawatir. In other words, these hadiths are in the minority. Those hadiths that have absolute proof, irrefutable proof, they are like a handful. So as we know that there is maybe 70 or 100, or maybe at the most 200 mass transmitted hadiths, as for the forgeries, there is less than that we can know, we know for sure. Because what you need is a categorical proof, and most of the proofs are circumstantial. There are so many things that should not have been included as examples because they are feeble examples. The example themselves of the da'if hadith or the forged hadith is a da'if proof. So this is not acceptable from you. You have to bring strong proofs when you discuss something like that. A theoretical work on the practice and understanding and definition of forgeries, you have to give something that is ironclad, that is agreed upon, not something filled with holes that takes the water and sinks. No, as soon as it has left the port, it has sunk already. And then he mentions Umar ibn Badr al-Mawsili in his book Al-Mughni an al-Hifz wal-Kitab, under the chapter on the fitna of property, of being rich, the fitna of wealth, and so forth. So he takes this as his reference. But this book is notoriously rejected even by Sheikh Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda as unreliable. If you had read Sheikh Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda's books carefully, you would have known that, because he has a long section on this book, a study on this book, showing this book is unreliable. it is not al-Mughni. And people before him said this Mughni an al-Hifz is not Mughni an al-Hifz. Yani it fails to carry out the promise of its title. So in other words, to show it as a reference shows that the person quoting it is unreliable. The next reference, he says, the innovation of al-kharqa sufiya, torn garments of the Sufis. This is how he translates it. No, first of all, it's not kharqa, it's khirqa, khirqa. And khirqa simply means any cloth that you put on top of yourself, and it, like a jubba even, you can call it a khirqa. But it became a symbol for the cloak or the jubba of the Sufis because it is made of wool. And anyway, it represents silsila. So when you receive the khirqa, it's the same as receiving the turban. Even the cloth of the turban is called the khirqa. This is a khirqa. It does not mean that it is torn or in tatters. But we wouldn't mind if it was torn. Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, he wore clothes that were torn and patched up in 12 places. He was not ashamed to be a Sufi or to be like someone of Zuhud in dunya. This is the meaning that counts. It is not the outward appearance. Anyway. The ulama of hadith have accepted the hadith on the khirqa because it is for barakah. The khirqa, receiving the khirqa and the silsila of that reception is also among the musalsalat of hadith that Imam al-Sakhawi, Imam al-Suyuti and very many others mentioned. And I have mentioned in my remarks on this passage that Sheikh Ahmad ibn Taymiyyah himself has prided himself, and this is where we might stop because it is enough. I just want to show you the passage in Arabic. This is something that every lover of Sheikh Ahmad ibn Taymiyyah should be acquainted with. Otherwise, they do not truly love him. They do not truly follow him. His Sufism, his at-tariqa affiliation, as narrated from the Shaykh of our Shuyukh, the Hafiz of Damascus, who was a very dedicated Sufi. But he was an ardent lover of Shaykh Ahmad ibn Taymiyyah and defender of his. Shaykh Hafiz Yusuf ibn Abdul Hadi al-Hanbali, buried in Damascus. So these are from the Maqadisa, from the people of Jerusalem, Quds, who came, emigrated to Damascus and founded the Hanbali school there in As-Salihiyah, where I lived for 9 years. So I would study in their buildings, I would pray in their mosques, I would visit their graves, and I would read Fatiha for them. And I benefited from their lights, alhamdulillah. And I can say that I have love in my hearts for them, even despite their mistakes, despite their sometimes aberrations and different positions, even in aqidah that we do not agree with because they are incorrect. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive them. So he says, فقد روى الحافظ يوسف ابن عبد الهادي الحنبلي الصوفي الدمشقي الشهير بابن المبرد. He narrated من طريق الحافظ ابن ناصر الدين الدمشقي. Through the Hafiz of Damascus, also ابن ناصر الدين, he was a Shafi'i muhaddith and Hafiz of Hadith. He also has مسلسلات. عن الحافظ ابن رجب الحنبلي الصوفي الدمشقي, a deep scholar, a very Sufi scholar of the Hanbali Mazhab, who disagreed with his Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah in fiqh issues, among others. An al-Hafiz Shams al-Din Ibn al-Qayyim al-Hanbali al-Sufi al-Dimashqi. So from Ibn al-Qayyim, and the books of Ibn al-Qayyim are full of tasawuf. It is actually, this chain is musalsal through Hanbali Sufis, except for Ibn Nasir al-Din, who was Shafi'i. عن الشيخ أحمد بن تيمية الحنبلي الصوفي القادري from شيخ أحمد بن عبد السلام بن عبد الحليم ابن تيمية. Actually ابن تيمية is not his father's name, it is his great grandfather's name. So we say أحمد بن تيمية to shorten it up. الحنبلي الصوفي القادري الدمشقي رحمه الله أنه قال, he said, لبست الخرقة المباركة. I wore the blessed خرقة, أي خرقة التصوف, من جماعة, from a group of them, منهم, among them, الشيخ عبد القادر الجيلي, الشيخ عبد القادر الجيلاني, يعني through شيوخ, because الشيخ عبد القادر الجيلاني was centuries before ابن تيمية, so not directly from him, but through intermediaries. وطريقته أجل الطرق المشهورة, and his tariqa is the most glorious, the most patent and majestic and obvious of all of the famous turuq. You see, so this is a words of praise for tariqa and all of the tariqas of tasawwuf. كذا في كتاب بدء العلقة بلبس الخرقة. Thus, in the book, the beginning of attachment through the wearing of the khirqa, يعني the cloak of tasawwuf. So, the attachment to what? To Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because that's the whole purpose. This is why they said, we will take this chain because it has too much barakah in it. So it is not, might not be historically defensible from the isnad viewpoint. This is Imam Sakhawi's words. But nevertheless, we accept it and we bless ourselves with it. So this is what Ibn Taymiyyah's also attachment through Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani, because ultimately to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that book, we have it also, Bad al-Ulqa, the beginning of attachment through the wearing of the cloak by Ibn al-Mibrad. We have it. It has been published more than once. We have the Damascus edition. We have the Amman edition. And it is from a manuscript that is kept in the Arabic collection of Princeton. So it's, until now, it has not been published. One wonders why. No, do not wonder why. You know exactly why. They have published all of his books, 3-4 editions each, and yet they have left this out. Subhanallah. ويوجد منه نسخة في جامعة دمشق. There is also one copy, one manuscript in the University of Damascus. And it is also mentioned, this isnad and the words of Ibn Taymiyyah, in المسألة التبريزية, his fatwa of Tabriz, because there is a group of scholars from Tabriz who wrote him asking something, and he answered. That fatwa also was never published. All of his fatwa were published. And so many different editions and with bigger and bigger volumes to make it, to amplify the importance of that literature and impress the public, but not Al-Mas'alat al-Tibriziya for some reason, and not the the words of Ibn Abdul Hadi narrating through his chain what his Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah said. So Mas'alat al-Tibriziya, the manuscript is kept in the Zahiriya library in Damascus, and in that he says, حَيْثُ يَقُولُ, this is what I will read and we will close here inshallah, لَبِسْتُ الْخِرْقَةَ الْمُبَارَكَةَ لِلشَّيْخ عَبْدِ الْقَادِرِ. I wore the blessed khirqa belonging to Sheikh Abd al-Qadir. وَبَيْنِ وَبَيْنَهُ اثنان, and between him and me, two links. There are two links. أي شيخه ابن أبي عمر ابن قدامة الآخذ عن والده أبي عمر وعمه الموفق صاحب المغني. So meaning the Sheikh of Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Abi Umar ibn Qudam. And this Ibn Abi Umar took it from his father and from his uncle. His uncle being Ibn Qudama, Muwaffaq al-Din, the famous author of Kitab al-Mughni and other books, but the most reliable book of his, and because it is the most beneficial, also Encyclopedia of Comparative Fiqh, al-Mughni. That is him. And both of them, meaning the father and the uncle, who is Muwaffaq al-Din Ibn Qudama, took it from Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jilani, qaddasallah sirrah. So ponder this well, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Say, or our duty is only to warn and to counsel carefulness. So be careful from whom you take your deen. This matter is a matter of religion and of faith and the faith system. So be careful from whom you take your faith and your faith system. Wallahu ta'ala a'lamu wa ahkam wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.